This is a very important meeting for me. I was elected about a year ago to be the Police and Crime Commissioner for Hampshire, the Isle of Wight, Portsmouth and Southampton. And one of the key tasks that I have is to hold the Chief Constable to account for her modern, operationally effective policing, that she owns the complete responsibility, not interfered with by anything that I should do, to deliver operational policing. It is a separation of powers that really matters. It is one that I completely support. But on the community's behalf, any of the community, the people that are here today that have the energy and the time and the commitment to come here, and you're welcome, and those who will watch this session online via the film that we're taking of what we're doing today. But one of the key things that I'm required to do is publicly to ask questions that the community would like to ask of the Chief Constable, and to for her answers to be in the same way publicly recorded and available to the community so that they can see what they are. So this is a, we call it a compass meeting. It's held in a public place that is accessible to the public. We advertise it so people can apply to be here and submit questions before they come to this meeting. And it is specifically about me asking the community's questions of the Chief Constable. It is not about me answering questions about my role, which I do in a number of other places. So the first question then for the Chief Constable. My plan, the police and crime plan, which I hope you'll find online or have seen or know exists, is also a key part of what I'm required by law to create, identifies that my overarching priority is to keep us safer. And I make no apology on almost everything I say, the word safer comes up on a regular basis. Chief Constable, I'm sure you would anticipate and that our community's first question today relates to hearing from you about how concerned they should be about the incidents recently in London, and particularly in the context that we've been at a threat level of severe for some time. What does this mean for keeping us safe from such acts of terrorism locally?
Of course, it's a really, really relevant question, Commissioner. So the recent tragic events in Westminster are at the forefront of all of our minds. And as you say, we are a threat level nationally, which is severe. And we have been for many years now. And that doesn't mean in any way that we're complacent. What severe means is that an attack is highly likely. The only place higher that the threat level can go is critical, and that would mean where there are very specific intelligence that a specific attack was going to happen, and that would be for usually a very short period of time. It hasn't happened in this country for a long time. So we've been at severe for some time, which means that an attack is highly likely. That threat level is a national one. It's the same for us here across our constabulary area as it is for the rest of the UK. There's no difference between us and London in terms of that threat level. And the reason that that is there and it should be shared very widely is we keep ourselves safe by all of us as citizens understanding how we can best keep ourselves safe. So regardless of the current threat level, we take that very seriously. So should we be more worried now than we were before Westminster? No, we should continue to be alert and alive to the threat that we have. So there's a number of ways that we go about things, and members of the public may well be aware of the government's contest strategy and the four P's, which are protect, prepare, pursue and prevent. And I'll explain all of those. We've had that nationally for some time. It's not a police owned strategy, but clearly the police have a really important part to play in that. In terms of protect, that means strengthening our overall protection against terrorist attack. And that's everything from physical barriers through to helping businesses protect themselves and know what to do in the event of something happening in their locality. So there's a great deal that goes on there, and the police have a significant part to play in that. In preparing, the prepare means should the unthinkable happen, as sadly it happened only 10 days ago, then how can we mitigate against that attack? How can we best deal with it? Pursuing means trying to stop people in their tracks, trying to catch people who are determined to do us harm and to stop those terrorist attacks happening. And you'll know nationally that that's been very successful and has been for some years in stopping many. And then the prevent is local authority owned, but that is trying to stop people who may find themselves caught up and being radicalised with extreme views. Can be extreme right as well as other radical views, and local authority owned, but again, the police have a dedicated team within that. And that's very closely aligned with our neighbourhood policing team. So stop trying to identify and spot people, often through schools or through neighbourhood teams, who may be subject to radicalisation and to prevent that going further. But there's something that we can all do. So we know that terrorism is global. We should all be vigilant. And often if we see things online that concerns us, we should report that immediately. But there's a real local feel to keeping ourselves safe from terrorism as well, and making sure that people do, if they are concerned, tell someone, do something about it, and don't rely on someone else doing that. It's very important. There's also a statutory body across the Constabulary area called the Local Resilience Forum, which has all the blue light services, it has all the local authorities, it has the military, it has water and electricity companies, it has voluntary sector. And our job together, and we've been at this a long old time, our job together is to plan for bad things happening, not just terrorism, but it can also be floods and flu and things like that. And also to plan to help people prepare themselves, businesses prepare themselves, and then be ready and practiced, as we saw very ably from Metropolitan Police and their other London colleagues, should something happen, be very good at responding quickly and effectively. And we have those plans in place here, and we practice them very frequently, as you would hope and expect. So it is something that's at the forefront of our mind. For me, terrorism is everything from the local special constable, the local police community support officer, the local officer, through to the very specialist firearms officers, the specialist investigators, and everything in between. And it is something very much that our local response is tied in with a national, very, very effective tasking that comes from the national counter-terrorism policing world. But of course, your commitment, and my commitment therefore as well, very much, is to that local policing footprint, which is at the heart of this.
And so if people are concerned, they should report their concerns as we would expect them to do normally.
Absolutely.
Right?
So if anyone is concerned about, and clearly if there's a suspect package or anything like that, then 999, no question, it's an emergency, and I would want people to be confident in doing that. If they're concerned about someone who is a neighbour or someone whose perhaps behaviour has changed and they're concerned that they might be susceptible to those kind of ideological changes, then tell the local policing team if you would like to, tell the school, tell someone, tell a doctor, tell someone, because then we can collectively pick that up. And usually it's nothing, but we would rather know than not.
Okay. And in terms of people's reassurance, we often declare that Hampshire is a broadly safe place to live in. Is there anything about this incident that intrinsically changes that?
No, not in any way. It is still a very safe place
and
to be.
I think I heard you saying in your answer that you and your team and with colleagues elsewhere train and rehearse and understand that there are these risks. So however awful it may be on any day, these are things that are, we hope, will never happen, but if they do, they're part of your planning to keep us all safer.
Absolutely. And the excellent response that we all saw on our television and social media, where not just Metropolitan Police, but the ambulance service, the health service, the fire service, that whole response that moved so effectively in London, I know people would expect the same here, and we do practice that.
Okay. And the partnerships matter.
Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you very much. The public, onto a related question, the public outpouring of support and sympathy for PC Keith Palmer, his family, friends and colleagues, reflects the value the public place on our police and the respect that we hold them in. And I'm very conscious that as we sit here in Aldershot, where we are today, we have from within our own area a recent case of two officers being seriously injured in the course of their duties and nearby to where we are today. How are you ensuring that our constabulary's morale and safety is being sustained to ensure they're able to focus on their work in keeping us safer?
clearly the morale and safety of those who serve us in policing and beyond matters enormously. And as you say, our colleague PC Keith Palmer so tragically died, as did those other people on the bridge those days ago. And can I say thank you? We've had so much, even in Hampshire Constabulary, so many letters, we've had cakes in, just social media messages from people saying thank you for what you do, which has been wonderfully received and appreciated by all my colleagues. And we've been really struck by that, bearing in mind, it was London, it wasn't here, but we had that kind of support, which is superb. But clearly the morale and safety of our colleagues here matters enormously. We did have the very serious attack on two police officers here in Aldershot a few weeks ago. Thankfully, one of those is already back at work, and I anticipate the other one will be hopefully this week, and I'm hoping to see both of them with their team on Friday morning and joining them at their shift there. That was a clearly very unrelated matter, but thankfully it doesn't happen very often that someone should be as injured as they were, and I take that very seriously indeed, and it concerned me a very great deal that it happened. So what do we do about it? Well, police officers and staff are expected to move towards danger as opposed to away from it. They are expected to go into situations to keep the public safe. That's our duty, and one that we take seriously and are honoured to do. And there's lots of things that my job is to, as their chief constable, to make sure that they have the training and the equipment they need to do that as well as they possibly can. Now that means everything physically, from the body armour, from handcuffs, from the asps that they carry. We have a number of officers who carry tasers. About 350 across Constabulary area carry tasers. That's in addition to our firearms officers. We have recently, as people may well know, rolled out spit guards across the Constabulary area. And that was a very carefully thought through and widely consulted on decision, which I'm very confident in, because the reality was, over the last year, 120 officers and staff were deliberately spat at, and usually that includes blood, and it's a deliberate attack, which I'm sure people can imagine what that feels like, and then the worry that someone has when they have to wait for various tests and the results of various tests to know if they're infected or not. So that has real impact on people's personal lives. So there's a lot of physical things that we do to protect our colleagues. There has been a national uplift in firearms officers, which you've funded, Commissioner. Obviously, I'm not going to explain here the numbers, because clearly I wouldn't want that information to be in the wrong hands, but suffice to say, we have uplifted our numbers of firearms officers who are on our roads 24/7, as well as having their specialist assets as well. But that all counts as very kind of top end and physical protection, but actually officers and staff keep themselves safest by speaking, by their communication skills, and we focus really heavily on training for all of us in how people should de-escalate through conversation, through body language, and indeed one of our own Assistant Chief Constable leads on that nationally as to how we as a service can make sure that we are doing our very best to take the sting out of what can be a risky or a hostile situation. We also think very carefully about how we crew people. So we have just shy of 1,000 people who are our emergency responding officers. And we look very carefully at whether we send them in ones or twos to various incidents. And we do that through the information we gather over the phone when incidents come into us. So we make a risk assessment about who should go and what skills they should have and in what numbers they should attend. So we do that very regularly. But sadly, officers and staff are assaulted. It is never acceptable that should happen. It's not part of their job. So within Hampshire Constabulary, we've pioneered something now which is being rolled out not just across the UK, but actually internationally as well, around what's called the 7-point plan for how we look after officers and staff when they have been assaulted. And that's just making sure we wrap around them the immediate things they might need, but also helping them deal with it and get back to work quickly and well and emotionally fine as well. In terms of the wider morale that you asked about, Commissioner, we do take that very seriously. I believe that my job as the Chief Constable is to make sure that the workforce is as fit and able as it can be in order to serve the public as well as we can. So we have a whole wellbeing and people strategy, which involves lots and lots of things, from flexible working to making sure that people have got advice about finances, that they're not worried about that kind of thing, that we are we make sure that people take their leave and that that's monitored, that we make sure they're not working excessive hours, that we have gym facilities in the new buildings that your States team are putting in place for us. So there's a huge amount that we put in there because we have a commitment, it's very similar to the military commitment, almost a covenant with our workforce, that we ask them to do difficult things and therefore we should look after them so they can do those to the best of our ability. But it is something that I monitor. Our morale surveys were low 2 years ago. They are now an awful lot better. They're still not good enough. So I do keep that temperature check personally, and whenever I go out and speak with officers and staff, it's something I check in with. So there's more to do, but we are doing a very great deal about it.
So one of the reasons to ask is because we need, the community needs policing to be the best it can be, and it respects that, and you've heard recently that that's very deep held and long held respect, but we do need to look after our team and professionally look after them in the modern age. And so that's a priority for
Absolutely.
You within your results. Good.
I have six within the police and crime plan. I've turned for within the constabulary, the way I'm delivering that for you is through six areas, one of which very much is looking after our staff in that way.
And for those of you here present, I should be very clear that just because they're the police, it doesn't mean that very many of them aren't my constituents and the public, who also have the right to vote and also have the right for the Police and Crime Commissioner to care about their safety every bit as much as everybody else's safety. And that's a key part of what I also want to challenge with the personal responsibility I have of the Chief Constable. And that's partly to respect the policing is of the community, in the community, and to, if I'm empowering the Chief Constable to deliver operationally effective policing, I must also challenge her to deliver that for the workforce as well, to allow them to concentrate on the job, which does keep us all safer. Yeah. It's just a little comment from me. A different question. In recent presentations that you and I have made, and some of your senior team have been making, and public sessions, including the rural conferences and the council tax setting consultations, you've outlined, and your colleagues have outlined, some changes in crime and criminal behaviours and described them as an iceberg of new risks and vulnerabilities. How does a community, how does an individual in the community balance understanding the risk of today whilst also being reassured that they live in a safe environment?
It's a perpetual balancing act, I think, for policing, and has been through the ages. So I'll explain the iceberg in a moment, but across our constabulary area, we serve inner cities, we serve very rural, we serve island communities, we serve market towns. There's a huge breadth of difference of policing that we serve. And so one size does not fit all. And we do try and nuance our delivery according to community needs. And of course, a lot of the success of policing is nothing bad has happened. So the absence of crime, the absence of harm is a success factor. And sometimes that's, of course, quite difficult to articulate because it hasn't happened. We've stopped it happening. But the iceberg analogy is meant to be helpful in that it's to show how crime has shifted. So crime has shifted over the last generation very much from being in the public place to being in the private place. So the iceberg is still above the water, the crime that one can see. So that is everything from having your car broken into, your house broken into, assaults, antisocial behaviour, Friday night drunkenness. The reality of those is they are all much, much smaller than they were 10, 15 years ago. The reality is that there is a much, much lower incidence of that. And then what you have below the waterline of that iceberg are private crimes, crimes that are hidden from public view. Domestic abuse is clearly a huge one. This is not a new crime, but we're certainly hearing more about it. People are much more confident in coming forward. Lots of the very serious sexual offences. My personal view is there is no greater incidents in the real world happening, but from the police perspective, I'm pleased to say we know much, much more, because people are telling us both the things that are happening right now, but also things that have happened perhaps in the past to them. Things like human trafficking, things like child sexual exploitation, online fraud, and that kind of thing. These are things that are done outside of the public eye. And so what the police response means to be that even, as I say, perhaps 10 years ago, it was our job to deal very well with what came to us. So if it was someone came to tell us about something, we would deal with it. Our duty has changed, and our duty is to go and find those hidden crimes, those things that are below the waterline of that iceberg, and then to be excellent at dealing with them when we find them. So that really shifts where we put our attention and where we put our resources. So whilst there are serious crimes both in the public and the more private domain, some of the things, the very serious things that we deal with, the public are unaware of. They won't know, and I don't want people to be worried or concerned, because this is a very safe area. But it's often things that can happen in the home that we need to spend our time on, as well as, of course, the very, perhaps the word is traditional, perhaps the wrong word, but I hope you know what I mean, crimes with things like vehicle crime and so on. So how we make the balance of where we put our attention. Every year we do an annual assessment, a strategic assessment of the threats which are across our constabulary area, and we then set those into our operational priorities. They won't surprise you, but they are protecting vulnerable people, and that's everything from children to the elderly to people with particular difficulties through mental health. The second one is tackling organised criminality, which harms our towns, our villages, our neighbourhoods. So we tackle that organised crime and try and deal with it upstream. And the third one is building community cohesion, very much looking for communities to work together, to be stronger together, so that they themselves keep themselves safer. So those are the three that are our operational priorities, and then we allocate our resources accordingly. But of course, we don't do that on our own. So a lot of that, we are also supported by regional groups such as the Regional Organised Crime Unit, which serves the South East, as well as national, so things like Border Force or the National Crime Agency. So we don't operate in isolation. We work in that kind of group of others that work alongside us, perhaps the onion of services, to help keep our residents safe.
There's still a question when you present that argument for the priorities of policing and the changes in crime, there's still a response from the community that says, ah, but I don't see police as much. Does what you've just described, does that change the visibility of police because they're doing something to keep us safe, or is that a separate question about visibility?
I mean, they're not unconnected, so it does impact. So there are lots and lots of us, but we are dealing with things. So for instance, we know we keep children safe now online because they're on their screens, on their laptops, in their bedrooms, wherever else. We keep them safe online through people sat in London monitoring social media and getting upstream and stopping people grooming kids online, much more than foot patrol parks, as an example. So that's where the risk has changed, that private from public risk in lots of areas of crime has changed. So therefore, we should put our people where they need to be to stop that crime happening. So does that mean that they're less visible for that kind of thing? Yes, that would be the case. But I think there's more to it than that as well. Okay.
And if people are saying they want to see policing more visibly, are there key things that they should ask themselves? If there's a reason for that, should they be reporting that differently from as they've done in the past? If they have something to report, are we accessible enough? Are your police colleagues mm-hmm. available enough? Is that understood by the community?
Well, we do. I'm sure there's room for improvement there. So the easiest way to contact us by telephone is 101. Obviously, if it's an emergency, then it's 999. But also through Hampshire Alerts, through local police neighbourhood teams, all of our neighbourhood officers, PCSOs, will have their own mobile phone number. Clearly, if they're off for a couple of days, then I wouldn't expect them to pick that up. So if it was more urgent, then people should use other routes. But we are also looking to improve our internet site as well for public access. And we're at the forefront of that nationally so that we can have much greater direct engagement for those who do want to contact us online. We know that isn't everybody, but an awful lot of people do. And so that's the way we make ourselves accessible in that way. But I would always want people, if in doubt, to ring.
And I know you and I have spoken about it before, but I just want to check in public that this will be the case. I look at a lot of statistics about how the community feel about police responses, and those who have sadly suffered a crime or know people that have suffered crime, their welcoming of the quality of police response is very high generally. And those who have heard the rumour of crime have reservations because of a sense of fear of crime rather than the reality of it. Is that something we can work on? Is that something that matches the people's sense that they're not seeing as many police? Maybe they don't need to see them because they're doing the job elsewhere? Does that let us off, or is that real?
My professional sense is that is real. I think there is more that I should do to explain that, to make that known, because when I do have an opportunity such as this to explain, then I know that's always welcomed. So I think there is a challenge for me to further explain the realities of how safe our areas are, because they are. But when something does happen, actually, as you say, people are always invariably really, really pleased with the service that they get. I would always much prefer it didn't happen in the first place, of course.
Okay. I want to move on to occasionally things aren't as perfect as they might be. Her Majesty's Inspector of Constabulary, HMIC, many people hear it, the abbreviation, inspect constabularies across the country, and we see them frequently here. Hampshire Constabulary has a proud record of good assessments, demonstrating the effectiveness of our constabulary's work to keep communities safer. So far, so good. But at the recent HMIC inspection of police effectiveness, their report included some areas that required improvement. In particular, the report said Hampshire Constabulary, generally protects vulnerable people well. However, HMIC has serious concerns about the way in which the force is supporting some victims of domestic abuse. Can you explain the context of this assessment and tell the community how you're addressing these concerns?
Absolutely, Commissioner. I take this very seriously. This is not a constabulary that is comfortable at all with any area of our external inspection being requires improvement. It's not a place I intend that we should stay, and we take it very seriously. We're inspected very frequently to a very great level, which I welcome. I think with the kind of powers that we as an agency have, that's entirely appropriate. I think inspection is important, and that public reporting for you and for others is really important. But there are some very specific things, and thank you for being careful in your language, because it was some victims in some circumstances that HMIC drew our attention to. And there were two key things. One was a practice that I paused in December 2016, and I use the word pause carefully. This is a practice whereby for domestic abuse situations, which are standard risk, so we have high, medium and standard risk. So the example could be a partnership is split up, the other partner lives elsewhere in the country in the north of England and has started sending letters or something like that that are abusive in nature. So it's important for us to deal with it, but it's not an urgent situation, to give that kind of example. We were dealing with those on the telephone, because actually a great part of the service that is needed is signposting to other services. It's that sometimes a criminal justice route is right, often it isn't. And we have fantastic services across the constabulary area, not delivered by the police, but delivered by many, many other partners, which actually are much better suited to solving and resolving that situation than the police. So effectively, we with the inspectorate had a professional disagreement about whether that was as least as safe as sending a response officer to that scene. So I paused it in December. We are undertaking academic research right now with the full blessing and support of the College of Policing and the full blessing of support of the National Police Chief Council's lead on domestic abuse, because actually there we need to be creative to innovate with all public services, you know, squeezed resources, to make sure we're using those to the best of our ability. So we have a difference of professional opinion. So I've paused it. That felt the right thing to do while we gathered this academic evidence. And then we will go have a dialogue with HMIC, which they're very aware of and very willing to have. So that was the first point. The second one was that they highlighted to us was our arrest rates for domestic abuse. Now, that is something that I absolutely agree we needed to improve upon. Arrest in every case is not the right answer. Our research and research internationally would suggest that an arrest rate just shy of 50% is about right for the kind of situations that arise. And clearly arrest can be very important in taking the sting out of a situation and creating a safe space, regardless of whether there is a subsequent prosecution or not. Interestingly, when we do prosecute, we have excellent conviction rates. Indeed, I was with the head of the Crown Prosecution Service this morning, as we both were, at another meeting where we are doing very well across our area. So when cases do go to court, we are prosecuting them very successfully. But HMIC had a view, which I share, that we were falling short of that arrest rate. So right now we're arresting at 42% of cases. I would expect that to nudge a little bit higher, but not much higher. But as you've said, they also said in their report that our officers and staff assess the risk to vulnerable people well, and they take effective steps to safeguard victims, and that the force is good at identifying safeguarding needs of victims of crime, and it's committed to supporting victims of crime with effective systems and process. So there are two very specific issues that we need to take account of, and we are. And there are, I have an action plan for each of the areas they've raised. We report back to HMIC very regularly. We're required to do that, as you know, and we will do so, and I will ensure that the right improvements are made. Interestingly, not Constabulary owned, but there was, in the early part of this year, a joint targeted area inspection for the Hampshire County Council area, which said that collectively, not just the police, but the County Council, youth offending teams, probation service, and everyone else involved in that whole range of services which a family suffering domestic abuse can call upon, that were very, very strong indeed, one of the strongest they'd seen in the country. So I take a lot of heart from that. And clearly from the police side, we do in Hampshire, as we do in Portsmouth, Southampton and on the island. So I'm not complacent. I don't like the Constabulary having requires improvement. I am committed to us not being in that place, and we are focusing our attention on it.
And so for anybody who has only heard the particular issues that you've just described, can we reassure them? Can you reassure them on behalf of the Constabulary and your colleagues in the Constabulary that they should feel very confident to report any issue of domestic abuse, and that they will be respected for doing that and surrounded by the necessary actions and protection?
I absolutely would reassure them in that way, Commissioner. And indeed, beyond that, we know that our satisfaction for those who, I mean, it's a terribly invasive, horrible situation for people to find themselves in. But we know that when they do ask for our help, they are very pleased with the help we give. And that may not be a criminal justice route, as I've explained. It might be from others. And indeed, once we had this report from Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary, we asked for, my deputy Sarah Glenn asked for anyone who felt they hadn't been treated well, particularly with the on the phone service, to let us know. And we publicised that very widely. We had one person come forward, and we've followed up with them. So we know that when people do ask for our help, they are very pleased with either what we do ourselves or where we signpost them to other services.
And I was very delighted to see your deputy respond immediately to that question, exactly as you've just described. So that was encouraging to me, but it needs to drill down through all of our team, that's for sure.
Absolutely.
And I just want to say out loud, while I have the attention of the camera and the people that are here, that mitigating domestic abuse, intervening where there are cases of domestic abuse, is really important and a priority for me. And it's something that there is no challenge or difficulty in the response that I see and perceive day by day from the Constabulary and from all the other partners, which the Chief has just described, who do some great work to protect people who are vulnerable and in some cases have been living with that realise risk for a very long time, and that's just unacceptable in the community. We should not be tolerating that. Good. Another question from me to you. I'll stop speaking to the camera myself. It's very difficult for a police and crime commissioner not to want to say something. So this is my challenge to the chief constable. So I'll get back to that. My police and crime plan sets a priority for championing community needs. Chief Constable, you'll know that for many, even a majority of the public, their first questions and concerns relate to very local issues, often of antisocial behaviour, speeding, cycling on pavements, property theft, that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. How are these community concerns in the context of the iceberg you were describing earlier and the resources that you have, how are they addressed in your tasking of local policing assets?
So the way that works is every local area has a local district commander who's a chief inspector, supported by inspectors and sergeants and constables and police community support officers and special constables. And that local neighbourhood policing team is very much dedicated to that locality. And their job is to tie in with their community, to hear those priorities, to meet with partners such as local authority and voluntary groups and so on, to work out how best to problem solve the issues. Sometimes that can be a conflict. So I was interested in your question about what people need. Sometimes what people need and what they want are not the same thing. And I know there are times when what local people might want their local police to do are things that we cannot do. And I don't hide from that. It is the reality of modern policing, and I'm really happy to talk that through and to debate that. But to give you some examples, speeding is a real issue. There are far too many people still, I'm afraid to say, killed and seriously injured on our roads. And it's one of what's called the fatal four. So the fatal four are excess speeding, no seatbelt, using your mobile phone or other distraction. And we know recently of that awful tragedy on the A34 just north of our Constabulary area. And then drink or drug-induced driving. So those are the fatal four. And there's a huge amount of work that goes on across a partnership much wider than just the police, so highways agency, local authorities, charities and others, to do a great deal of education, to stop people doing that kind of behaviour. There's engineering, so designing out risk areas in some of our roads and things like that, as well as enforcement. And there is a role for enforcement, and we have a dedicated roads policing team who will pick up on that as well. So we do take that very seriously, and it is something that continues to be a concern that I have, and I'm sure community have. But we're supported by an army of nigh on 1,100 community speed watch volunteers across the Constabulary area, and they are fantastic. And they're the ones that you see in your own village or your own neighbourhood with their speed gun and very high visibility jackets. And so the 1,100 of them, just in 2016, they sent out nearly 20,000 letters to local speeders, which is all part of that education. Because if it's pointed out, people usually stop. So the power of that, and that's real, you know, communities helping themselves and keeping themselves safe. So we have 1,100 volunteers running about 100 community speed watch schemes around the Constabulary area, which is fantastic for education. So it's something we do worry about. You mentioned antisocial behaviour. This is something that can be a real blight on a neighbourhood and on a community. And we work alongside, again, local authorities here to tackle antisocial behaviour. And we have a very tried and tested route whereby we, however and whoever gets to hear about it, we pool that information together in one place. And then we work out who's best placed to try and get it to stop. And there's high, medium, low risk, as you would expect. Neighbourhood teams, that's real bread and butter work for them. It's something they should be doing day in, day out. And of course, they're co-located often with local authority, sometimes with fire and rescue colleagues. And we always make sure that all the people are around the table to prioritise that. And we've actually had some award-winning schemes across the Constabulary area as well, which has been really good to see. We do use the powers available to us, so there are things like dispersal powers that we can use, so people have to disperse in certain circumstances. We have very, very effective community courts for young people, whereby a young person who's done some kind of low-level antisocial behaviour or offending is dealt with out of the formal court system, by a panel of their peer group, which is very, very impactive and has been proven to really, really work to nip that offending in the bud. But there are things that we don't and we won't prioritise. So you mentioned cycling on the pavements. If we see it, we will deal with it, of course. But it's not something, unless it's really, really dangerous, that we would prioritise. And I know sometimes that's difficult. And I know that's something that certain people would not want me to say. But I feel it's very important to be straightforward. So it's something we'll deal with if we find it. But we wouldn't necessarily go looking, as I say, unless it was particularly dangerous. And then you asked about property theft. It always matters to us. And we always want to know when someone suffered that. If it's a house burglary, of course, we will do a fantastic investigation around that. If it's something stolen from a car, it really depends on whether how much harm it is. So if it's your tools and that's your livelihood, then that has a real impact on you to have that stolen from your van. If it's a bag of shopping that you've left on the back, it's really, you wish it hadn't happened. I wish it hadn't happened. But the level of investigation that we put into that might vary. So we do vary along those lines. We're really aware of business crime and rural crime particularly. We know the harm and the impact that having something stolen from your farm or your small business can really impact your viability as a business. So we take that very seriously, of course. And through your commissioning, we have the Country Watch scheme in rural areas, which is very widespread and very effective.
Moving from the very local to the initiated globally almost, can I ask, what is the Constabulary doing to raise awareness of cyber-enabled crime, and what impact are you making on local incidents when this type of crime lands on people living in our community?
This is a real concern for us, and I'm sure, I suspect, there isn't a person in this room who hasn't been a victim one way or another of an attempted cyber attack. So, and we may not, of course, even be aware of it. So it's a real threat to our modern way of life. It's a very fast-growing area of crime, and there are two distinct groupings. There's cyber-dependent crime and cyber-enabled crime, and I'll explain the difference. So cyber-dependent crime is crime that didn't happen before the internet existed. So an example of that, which lots of businesses suffer, is a denial of service attack where someone will attack your business computer, lock it down effectively, and then ask you for a few hundred pounds to unlock it. So that denial of service only happens because of the internet. Cyber-enabled crime is crime that happened before but now happens in a different way. So fraud and defrauding, particularly the elderly and particularly isolated people, where people are kind of tricked into giving away their bank details and so on. And that happens a great deal, and it's something that really concerns me, particularly for our elderly residents, so that if it looks too good to be true, it is. And often we find that people, particularly the elderly who've suffered that, are very embarrassed, and then they don't tell anyone and they don't ask for help. So it's something that I would want us all as good neighbours to be aware of. So that's how cybercrime happens. In terms of what we're doing about it, like I said earlier, I'd much rather it didn't happen at all. So we're putting a great deal of effort into preventing it. That means we have a dedicated team who are about protecting businesses, giving businesses the information they need, giving individuals the information they need to keep themselves safe, because there's a huge amount that we can all do. I won't ask for a show of hands here, but the number of people whose password is password is frightening. So the very simple steps that we can all take to keep ourselves safe. We do cyber awareness work in our schools. Cyber bullying is a really invasive and nasty load of activity for young people particularly. We're working with Bedfordshire University to do some work there. We do lots of local media campaigns, often tied in with the national focus as well. And also around specific times of the year, we find that dating fraud can come to the fore. So we try and anticipate the kind of the seasonal trend. So there's a great deal that we try and do to prevent it. We also work with Action Fraud, which is a national body run by the City of London Police on behalf of all of us, where all online fraud and crime should be reported. And then they feed back to us ones that we can locally investigate, because they see the trends. Often this happens on quite a scale. It can sometimes happen from abroad in terms of where the source is. So they'll pick up where the investigation is best set and ask, you know, feed that back to us. So they do that coordination on behalf of everyone nationally. Hampshire Alerts is a really important one for us. We do try and use that very carefully so that we tailor our advice for cybercrime as well. And then we're leading nationally with our cyber volunteers and cyber specials. There are lots and lots and lots of people who are not people like me, who are experts in this field, and they are giving their time to us pro bono for free to help us make sure that we've got the up-to-date tools and ability and skills to tackle it. So we're at the forefront of that nationally, which is in line and in support of our dedicated digital investigation team, who have the real kind of specialist investigation skills for the very top end aspect. But actually, the vast majority of our effort is in stopping it happening and helping us all keep ourselves safe. And very grateful for the investment that you've made into this area recently, Commissioner.
And I presume you'd want to reinforce that we have a responsibility to look after ourselves digitally. There's been a lot of advertising this year from the High Sheriff and from the Youth Commission and from others reminding people, as I think you were doing, about having the right passwords and taking the right protective action. Thank you very much for that. The questions so far have been questions that I've heard from a wide range of members of the community, and they're the top of the pops questions for things that, if only I could ask the Chief Constable, these are the questions that I would ask if I had the chance today. Part of the Compass process, part of this process, is to advertise that this is taking place and to give members of the community the opportunity to ask their questions, either by being here today and asking questions or by submitting questions. So I'd like to move on to a couple of the questions that come from local people here and ask first, Trish Reddy, if you would ask your question. Thank you.
Why aren't the police proceeding with investigations when there is clear evidence which can lead to a successful prosecution?
Thank you, Trish. Very often we do. So we obviously want to know about any crime that's happened. We want to know about it. But then, as I said earlier, we do make a decision about whether to actively investigate or not. And we always tell the person on the end of it if we're not. We're very, very open about that. So solvability, i.e., you know, if there's really good evidence, that's a really big factor. So of course, if there's clear evidence, then we will. But we also look at the threat and the harm that's happened. So we work out the risk associated with it, I suppose, is a good way. And the example I gave about breaking into a van, if that's someone's livelihood, then that is a different impact. Also, we look at if it's part of a trend. So if someone has had their wing mirror broken off their car and that's one of 20 in a street, then we would want to understand what that pattern was and to try and solve it. So solvability is a factor, but it isn't the only one. We would look at, so for instance, if it was a young person who'd stolen something from a local shop, I would not want them to be going into the criminal justice system. I would want them to stop doing that and to understand why that was something that was wrong and the harm it causes, and so to learn a lesson. I would much, much rather that that's the way that was dealt with. So I really encourage my officers to deal with it in that way. And we also look at, we work hand in glove with the Crown Prosecution Service. So sometimes it's a police decision whether someone is going to go to court. And more often than not, we work and give information to the Crown Prosecution Service who make that decision. So sometimes it's us with someone else who decides if someone is going to court. But we do try to deal with, across the constabulary area, if it's really serious, then absolutely they must go to court. But if it's something that can be dealt with and we can stop a cycle of offending, then we would rather deal with it in that way. And there are some great examples around domestic abuse, people who perpetrate that, you know, who are being diverted from and are stopping the harm they're causing in different ways. So we do a lot of it, to answer your question, but we don't do it all of the time just based on whether there's good evidence or not.
Can I enlarge upon that or not?
Yes, I'm happy to.
Okay. I live in a one-way road, and a friend of mine had just dropped me off, and there was a car coming down the road the wrong way. My friend stopped the car and said, "Do you realise you're coming down the road the wrong way?" And the driver of this car said, "Yes, I know." And then he said a few profanities. And he threatened my friend, and he threatened to throw my friend's car keys out of the car. This chap actually got out of his vehicle. My friend had his dash cam on, so obviously he caught everything. When he got home, he reported it to the police, and a day or so later, he received a phone call saying, "Well, we're not going to proceed with this."
Well, I was hoping he was given an explanation for that. I don't know about that specific case, of course, Trish. I'm sorry, but I would hope that there'd been some explanation as to why. I would hope someone would have looked at the dash cam and so on. But if you want us to take the detail, we can come back to you on that specific case if that's helpful.
Okay, thank you. There are a lot of cars coming down the road the wrong way.
Right.
And it could lead to a sort of major accident one of these days.
Okay. So perhaps we'll hear more of that outside of the meeting. That's the offer. You've got someone to look at it very locally.
Okay, thanks for that.
Thank you very much. Trish, do you want to ask your second question?
Okay. Is it possible to have a police personnel available to speak with members of the public at Rushmore Borough Council offices in Farnborough? And just to enlarge upon that, I don't mean somebody sitting in reception all the time. I thought perhaps somebody was on duty one day, you know, that they would be available to the public.
Yeah.
Because quite often I find things in Farnborough. I found driving license, I found a watch, found several other things, and I've had to bring them over to Aldershot for to the Aldershot police station.
Okay. Yes, so I'm sure we can sort that out. What I'll do is I'll feed that back to the local chief inspector and ask her to look at that. But you can always, if you happen to see a police community support officer around in the town centre, that kind of thing, you can always ask them to do that. But no, I'll have a look at that. It's certainly something we can arrange.
Okay, thank you.
And we're very keen on advertising. One of the things that has come up in a lot of the conferences has been making sure people understand all the range of opportunities to contact the police locally, and that we push that out.
Yeah.
And I'm sure it's a good question to reinforce to make sure people know how to contact the people.
Yeah. I'll take that away.
Okay. Roger. Barbara, is that your questions?
Yes,
thank you for being here to ask.
Thank you, Commissioner, Chief Constable. You've mentioned in your opening words about the events of last week, how much you rely on neighbourhood policing for, if you like, intelligence, and also in tracking crime. But I just wonder what is the current policy and practice on neighbourhood policing? In the part of Aldershot where I live, we used to see the PCSOs and even, perish the thought, speak to them and get to know them. But over the last 2 years, nothing. They are not visible. They used to be on foot. Now, haven't seen them. And as for PCOs in towns, centres, no. So I'm wondering how you get the information that it's active, yet I, as Joe Public citizen, see zero. There must be something astray with our perception of what you think is going on at ground level.
Okay.
Thank you.
So, I mean, I take that very seriously. So, your local police are there. They should be accessible, and sometimes that's visible, and sometimes accessible means in a different way, online, on the phone as well, if they're in a different place. But they should certainly be accessible. And on our website, it's very clear who your local officers are and who your local police community support officers are. So they are there, and they are there committed to your area. I'm not doubting at all the point you're making. What I'll do, if I may, is feed that back to Chief Inspector Debbie Brooks, who's the Chief Inspector for Aldershot, and ask her to explain the detail. But to answer your specific question around are we still committed to visible policing? Yes, we are. There are, you know, there are only so many hours in the day, and they will be prioritised according to the specific areas of the town that they need to be in, and that may or may not be, of course, where you live. So,
understood.
So I would, I think it's a very fair question. I do know often that it would be great if there were more visible officers. Part of the commissioner's question to me earlier is that we keep people safe in lots of different ways, other than on foot patrol, and I do ask my officers to work in those very different ways nowadays because of the very different crimes that we need to protect. But that isn't to say they're not there. They are committed to your area, and their job is to problem solve where the problems are in any particular town, and that would be the same in Aldershot as it is elsewhere. So I will feed that back to Chief Inspector Debbie Brooks.
If you could, please, because we very rarely see policemen on foot, full stop, outside of the town centre or around the football ground on match days. And they're the only times when we see people on foot. Go 500-600 yards outside of the town centre and it's a rare event. So I think there seems to be something wrong with the either my perception of what's going on or what is actually going on. So if you could feed that back, that would be most helpful and constructive in visible policing in our town.
Happily, I don't, though, expect there to be lots of dedicated foot patrol of police officers, because their role is different from that for the reasons that I've tried to explain.
Yeah.
Sometimes, yes, but certainly not in the volume that years and years ago used to be available. It is a very different policing offer. We deal with very different crimes in very different ways. So, but that doesn't to say that we shouldn't do that, and that's certainly the PCSO's, Police Community Support Officer, role to do that.
Mr. Barber,
this
you've
is not the blue lamp.
Mr. Barber, I think you've reflected a number of other local people who've written about particular issues, about time of day and about particular locations locally. And I think between you've highlighted the need for the ability to have conversations with policing to hear what's happening in your area and their priorities. And I'm clear, and I'm sure the Chief would acknowledge, that one of the challenges that I give her is to make sure that we land the messages. Not only does she decide what the most effective operational policing is and put herself in the way of questions like today, but actually we ensure that we land them with the community as well, so that it's from an informed position. And that's part of my role as the Police and Crime Commissioner, but I'm sure the Chief will have heard that voice from
very
you today,
so.
which is reflective of a lot of voices of other people who've not quite asked a specific question, but have raised some issues, I should reassure you. I think that brings us to the close of the formal question and answer bit for today. I hope those of you that are present, and I hope those of you who watch this online, will find that the questions reflect issues that are important and priorities in the community's mind as they are at the moment. They're the questions that I have heard and that local people here today have asked. I just want to be clear to everybody that this is one part of the set of conversations that the Chief Constable and I have on a regular basis. That includes one-to-one sessions, that includes interacting in the event of an incident or some question that I receive as I go around with the public that needs immediate action or would benefit from clarity about the sort of messages that I hope you've been hearing today that are in the Chief's mind as she sets the priorities for operational policing on our behalf. So thank you very much for being here today. Thank you very much if you are for watching it. Thank you very much, one and all.